Okay, so hello everybody. I hope you can hear me online. Is it good? Everything? Yeah.
Perfect. We can hear you.
Okay, great. Okay, so welcome to our third session for the semi-salong this semester. Tonight we are very happy to have some locals. So we have Musajin from our PhD and Professor Timo from our department. And as you know, we will organize the session in this way that we will have presentations back to back, and I mean, yeah, presentations and questions, and then presentation and questions. So yes, and we are recording. So if you don't want to appear in the recording, you can let us know. You can also pose your questions at any time. You can write them in the chat, or you can in the session, in the Q&A session, you can just open your mic and ask questions to the presenters. And yes, so I think that would be all for me. And I would then just leave you with Musajin Nazaruddin. He's a PhD student from our department, and he focuses on eco-semiotics and semiotics of disasters. And his presentation is called Post-Disaster Landscape, Transformations and the Dilemma of Nature Culture. So I would leave you with him. And now I will just share the screen. And yes, so now you can see the presentation, right? Okay, I hope you can.
Okay, thank you, Israel. So can you all hear me in online?
Yes.
Okay, great. So Israel, how much time do I have for my presentation?
Around 45 minutes.
45. It's very long. It's like a giving full lecture. So the topic of my talk this afternoon is post-disaster landscape transformation and the dilemma of nature and culture. So this is one of my PhD paper that's still under review in one journal. And the paper starts from the idea that natural disaster will transform landscape in different degree, depend on the scale of the event or scale of the disaster itself. Also, then the recovery and mitigation processes often involve landscape changes. We can say that on the one hand, the physical transformation of landscape creates new meaning and interpretations. On the other hand, the existing entanglement with and memories about landscape will guide the post-disaster reconstruction and relocation processes. So my talk this afternoon targets the interplay of natural phenomena, government planning, and local perception in the transformation of post-disaster landscape. My basic idea in this paper is that post-disaster landscape transformation usually involve two seemingly contradictory modes, integrating nature and culture, or separating nature and culture. So as we know that the dichotomy of nature and culture has received very strong criticism from several angles. For example, the very famous philosopher Bruno Latour has argued that this dichotomy is a kind of modernist pitfall. He argued that culture construct nature, and on the other way around, then nature also construct culture. Similarly, then Donna Haraway has emphasized the hybrid phenomena or entities. In these entities or phenomena, then some part of them are culture, but some part of them is nature. And I will say that disaster, or especially natural disaster, is basically a hybrid phenomenon. It is not totally natural, but it is also cultural. In his criticism to nature and culture opposition, Philippe Discola highlight the diverse form of nature and culture relation that can take in different parts of the world. And I think in general, I will follow this line of argumentation. I want to demonstrate the diverse entanglement of nature and culture as represented in the post-disaster landscape changes. I will also say that diverse group in a single community may have different perspective on nature and cultural relations. Also, then a community may shift their perspective on nature and cultural relation depending on certain context. So, yeah, it depends on specific context. I will say also that instead of treating this dichotomy as a kind of ontological state, then semiotic study of landscape should be fully aware of very diverse modes of relation between nature and culture in different societies.
Hussein, sorry for interruption. Can you move aside the panel with the view for the viewers?
Sorry, something like this?
Yes.
Okay. Then the research question of my paper is how do the natural disaster and the subsequent recovery processes transform and shape local nature and culture relations? The second question is that how are they embodied and expressed in landscape transformation? And then how do this landscape transformation stimulate further cultural changes? I will divide my talk in some parts. After this introduction, then I will tell you about the empirical case of my study and the methods, and then I will move on to theoretical framework. Then after that, I will have three topics. The first topic is post-disaster spatial categorization. The second topic is post-disaster human settlements, and the third topic is disaster remembering and mitigation, and then the last part is conclusion. I'm not sure whether I can manage to present all of these topics. If time allows, then I will be very happy to share all of them, but if not, then I will only share perhaps the first and the second, or perhaps only the first. But then, yeah, I think even only the first, then I can show you the basic idea of my paper. So the case and the methods. I have two cases in my study. The first is the Indian Ocean tsunami in 2004, and then the second one is the Mount Merapi eruption in 2010. The first case is 2004 tsunami. It was the biggest and the worst natural disaster in the modern Indonesian history. It has killed more than 160,000 people, and then other more than 500,000 people were displaced. They have lost their family, their houses, and other fundamental assets of their lives. So it was very, very unimaginable. Then This tsunami has dramatically changed the landscape of some cities within the Aceh province. Many villages along the beach, along the shoreline, were totally washed away by the wave. And then next to the coastline, the tsunami destroyed almost all buildings. And then the second case is 2010 Mount Merapi eruption. It was big eruption of the 100-year cycle. I have to tell you that this volcano, Mount Merapi, is the most active volcano on Earth, not only in Indonesia, but in the world. This volcano erupts every 5 to 10 years. It is small eruption, and then the big eruption usually comes roughly every 100 years. So the last 2010 eruption was a big event, big eruption. And then this big eruption has totally destroyed some hamlets, and the landscape form of this hamlet have been dramatically changed due to the eruptions. In these two locations, I have done a series of ethnographic study, and then during this study, I have conducted participant observation, and then in-depth interview, informal discussion, and focus group discussion. So this is the picture of tsunami. I am sure picture talk more than words, so you can imagine the situation. It is the picture of before and after the tsunami. And then this one is the picture from Mount Merapi, the picture in the emergency periods after the 2010 eruptions. Okay, then I will share the theoretical framework of my study. And the main concept of my study is landscape. And in this sense, I follow Kati Lindstrom, who has proposed to understand landscape as holistic, historical, lived, contested, and dialogical phenomenon. As a holistic phenomenon, landscape links both physical form of landscape and the cultural ideas of that physical landscape. So this is not only physical, but also about the idea of the landscape itself. And then landscape is also historical because it always preserves the trees from the past. It always have some trees from the past of the society. And also landscape is a live phenomenon. So in this sense, then we, our body, which live in the landscape, taking in its cues and then being in interaction with all its semiotic processes. So in this sense, the meaning of landscape is created through everyday bodily practices, sensory communication, and dynamic interaction with other living and non-living agencies in the landscape. At the same time, landscape is also a collective phenomenon born with power relations. Every socio-economic formation creates its own landscape. Then landscape is very crucial ideological apparatus, as it is indeed familiar. So, many times it is taken for granted and tangible. So in this sense, then dialogue and communication that dynamically happen on different level involving multi entities are the core of semiotic process in the landscape. The second concept I use in my study is place. So any subject who is engaged with landscape can create smaller meaningful places within the landscape based on their activities in and engagement with this place. So in this sense, landscape and place have similarities. They are often shaped by daily routines. According to Yifu Tuan, people talk of the spirit, the personality, and the sense of place. So in this sense, place is a small piece of world, gaining its stable meaning, for example, from repeated experiences and certain beliefs. So compared to the small world of place, in the sense landscape is as telescopic notion. As telescopic notion, telescopic idea, landscape allow for any size of semiotic subject, and then can extend and reduce the size of the area under questions. So we may understand place as a small, meaningful unit within the landscape in the eye of the specific subjects. Therefore, different entities may have different places within the same landscape, or even different landscape have different landscape within the same physical locations. And then the next concept I use in my study is space. In contrast with the notion of place and landscape, space is more abstract and objectified category. It is the product of the work of surveyor and or cartographer, whose objective is to represent landscape, to take instrumental measurement from a considerable number of locations, and to combine this data to produce a single picture, which is independent of any point of observations. So compared to the landscape as social construct based on daily experiences, then space is more objectified and abstract. In this sense, spatial categorization is something that is also often applied for the purpose of governance. The governance, in order to reach some uniform principle in organizing the landscape and the place of specific communities. So there are three concepts that I use in my paper. So I think now I can move on to the first topic of my talk, that is post-disaster spatial categorizations. So in modern times, the most common post-disaster spatial production is clear-cut separation of disaster-prone area, which is commonly created on the basis of previous disaster events. On the slope of Mount Merapi, the disaster-prone area are mapped based on the eruption history of the last 100 years, and the newest version of this map. The latest version of this map, published after 2010 eruptions, has expanded the previous map. And this map has included some the highest hamlets within the disaster-prone region 3 to be included as the most dangerous area. It means that this hamlet should not be allowed anymore for human settlement. Then in the post-tsunami recovery in Aceh, the government established the tsunami-prone area based on the 2004 tsunami event and planned to build new human settlements outside this area. These official maps usually take into account the human population within or surrounding the area, as the primary purpose of this map is basically to avoid human casualties in the future possible natural disaster. However, I think that humans have been considered mainly as physical entities. At the same time, the ways of living, also the landscape as a meaningful environment for a human, have been ignored in this map. This map usually did not take into account local cultural adaptation, including their long entanglement with the landscape, with the surrounding landscape. So in this sense, then I can say that the maps usually constructed based on the separation idea of nature and culture. So in according to this map, the disaster-prone area is where nature is dominant, unpredictable, and dangerous. That's why humans should avoid this area, as they cannot control this kind of unstable nature. Okay, and then this is the map of Mount Merapi, the latest map of Mount Merapi. As you can see, there are four colors. The orange is the area of the peak of Mount Merapi, then the pink and the light pink and the yellow. The pink is the disaster prone region three, the most dangerous area nearing the peak. And then the yellow, the light pink is disaster region two, which is also still dangerous. And the yellow is disaster region three, which is the edge of the river, which flow river usually the lava flow in this river. And then this is the post tsunami spatial planning. As you can see, then next to the beach, next to the beach, then there are green area, green belt. It should be for example for mangrove plantation. Then after only after this green belt, the green area, then human settlement should be rebuilt in this yellow or orange area, not in the green area. This is the basic idea of this post tsunami spatial planning. Okay, but what will a perspective if we come if we started from the integration of idea, integration of nature and culture, then if the starting point is the integration of nature and culture, then the by definition, the separation of disaster-prone area as the basis for getting rid of human from this area does not make any sense at all. A local from Mount Merapi told me like this. He said that wherever we live does not matter. I breathe to live in the absolute hamlet. People can live together with hazard. The problem does not lie in the position, but in awareness and preparedness. So from this perspective, then we can see that the only proper way to deal with the instable natural condition is to understand and to properly respond to them, to integrate human and environment. In this sense, then avoiding these dangerous places due to the potential natural hazard should be contextual, which is only possible if human understand the rhythm and specific of the natural processes that influence their life. For example, then on Mount Merapi, when the volcano gets more active, the locals are used to read environmental cues to interpret the increasing activities of the volcano, such as rumbling sounds or repeated earthquake, smoke emitted from springs, animals running down from the forest, eagles cycling near the peak, or ants coming out from the ground in large number. It's also what Timo called as compound environmental signs, in which human and non-human animals share certain ecological codes. In this sense, then human prediction of the eruption partly rely on the interpretation conducted by other organisms. So a large number of ants coming out from the ground or animals running down from the forest are already interpretation performed by this living organism in response to the condition of the volcano, which is then in turn interpreted by human as a sign of eruptions. So in this point, then we can also see that how non-symbolic signs, iconic or indexical signs, have become the basis of strong interrelationship between nature and culture. So we can say also that the construction of disaster-prone area as guideline for post-disaster landscape planning, so that the government has taken the post-disaster reorganization as matter of space. In contrast, then the locals perceive the post-disaster landscape basically as a matter of place, which is depends on pattern of activities, connection, feeling of attachment, comfort, and belonging. So I think I can skip this part, and then the next is about the mixing of perspective. These two perspectives may possibly mix in the aftermath of any disaster, resulting in more complex combinations. The actors may dynamically shift their view at any disaster recovery steps or specific moments. And then we can recognize this shift from the government side, also from the local sides. From the government side, I found that the government regulation about the disaster prone areas is sometimes inconsistent and opportunistic. For example, then I can give example from the former Merapi. So on the slope of Mount Merapi, the official disaster zones, the official maps mention explicitly that disaster prone area 3 nearing the peak are prohibited for any human settlements. So later, based on this map, the local government has decided to erase the existing hamlet within this disaster area from the official map. So it means that these hamlets simply did not officially exist anymore. However, this political decision contradicts two other actions of the government. For example, then the government take retribution for tourists who come to Lavatour located in this area. So logically, as the hamlet did not officially exist anymore, then the government cannot do any development program in this area. Physical development, such as building infrastructure is prohibited, including developing tourism facilities. So the government do nothing in this area. This area does not exist anymore, something like this. But interestingly, when the locals develop their non-existent hamlets as tourist destinations, commonly called as Lavatours, and then this tourism was so much popular, thousands of people come in a single day, especially on the weekend, then the government come. They take retribution from the tourists. So this is a kind of opportunistic way of thinking, of opportunistic actions. In Aceh, then according to the official planning, the tsunami prone areas within a few kilometers from the beach should be used for green zone, as I say before, that in this area, there should be no human settlement there. Human settlement should be rebuilt next to this green belt, next to this green area. However, this planning was impossible to implement due to some factors, such as the absence of land resources, as the government did not have any budget to provide the land for the whole city, because the so many village that should be evacuated, almost the whole city should be evacuated, should be moved to the new settlement if the government want to implement their idea. So then this planning simply as a matter of planning. In the reality, then most of the new settlement have been rebuilt in the old places next to the beach. Even some public infrastructure such as school or health centers has been rebuilt really next to the beach and very, very near to the beach. So in this sense, then I think then the government, actually the government still kept in mind the separation perspective of nature and culture, but they have been forced to implement a kind of unwanted integration practice, something like that. Then this, in this unwanted integration practice, human physical body have been included through rebuilding their house in the old location. So yeah, human body, the locals' body, the locals as human, as a physical entity have been included in this relocation. But cultural consideration, cultural way of culture as way of living, were far away from the government decisions, very far away. I will give you a little example. After the tsunami, the government has granted ships, boats for some fishing communities. This indicates that the government already acknowledged that those staying within the tsunami prone area. So the government already acknowledged them. Then they gave them aids, but then those ships were not suitable for the locals' daily sailing practice, and then therefore they were unused, simply unused. And it shows that the government did not understand the local practice in fishing, in sailing, in going to the sea, because in Aceh then. Different fishing communities have different kind of ship, different kind of boats they use in their daily fishing. Okay, then the mixing of perspective can also happen within the locals. The locals' responses to the separation of disaster zones are very diverse, and then in this point, I found that in post tsunami Aceh, some communities, especially the fishing communities, whose livelihood rely on the sea resources, strongly show their fidelity to their homeland. They prefer to go back to their village even when the government has built a new settlement for them in the inland areas. So they prefer back to their old village. However, some other locals, especially who live on more urban areas or whose livelihood did not rely on the surrounding natural resources, then they have preferred to stay in new regions far away from the beach. They commonly have traumatic memories of the tsunami. Both people moving to the inland area or people staying in their old places. People who move back to the coast area, still they carry a similar kind of collective trauma. But it seems that they have associated this traumatic memory not with the whole landscape, but with more specific natural processes and their signs. For example, earthquake, rumbling sound from the sea, and others. A local woman who returned to her village next to the beach explained to me, she said that this is my village. I was born here. Many memories here with families, with parents, with children. That. Then I asked her whether she is still afraid of not to tsunami, still afraid of tsunami or not. Then she replied to me, "Yes, I'm still afraid of tsunami. If the waves are very big and the sound is rumbling, then I'm very afraid." But she said that we live near the sea. We know that we live in the very prone area of tsunami, but we know the sign of tsunami and where to run. Something like that. Yes. Okay. So. I found that during the normal times, the engagement with daily places are much more important compared to the abstract idea of disaster zones. people closely related or entangled with their volcano on Mount Merapi as a place to live, place to earn livelihood, place to graze for animal feed, and then place to gather with their communities, place for mining, place for tourism activities, and others. However, it does not mean that they are not aware of the spatial categorization of disaster-prone area. The locals on Mount Merapi are very aware of that. They are very aware that their hamlets are located within disaster zone 3 or 2, meaning that their places are very vulnerable to be directly affected by future eruptions. However, this awareness lays in the background during the regular time. It becomes the foreground and constitute their practices as and responses during the crisis. For example, when the volcano Mount Merapi was getting more active at the end of 2020, so that in 2020 and in at the end of 2020 until the middle of 2021, the volcano getting more active. At the time, almost all local communities in the highest hamlets did self evacuations without waiting for the aid from the government. So the perception that their place belonged to the disaster prone area was more prominent during the crisis. I can say also that in post disaster societies, the external vision of landscape, which usually emphasizes the disaster prone area, can be integrated with the local image of the landscape constructed through daily sensory and bodily interaction with the given landscape. We can also say that the distant perspective of space can be combined with a closer engagement with the place. In this sense, then the local are freely to activate a certain perspective and dynamically shift between them depending on specific functions. This suggests the contextualist or performative view of landscape that understand places as specific time and space configuration made up of of intersection of many encounters between actants or people and things. Nigel Thrift has suggested that places should be understood as dynamic, relational, and based on the idea of heterogeneous and expansive hybrid world, which is weaving all manner of space and times. So whether the local regard their environment as matter of space or as matter of place, then it depends on certain function that they need to activate in certain times and specific times. Okay. It's already mostly 40.
We have around 10 minutes.
10 minutes. Mm-hmm. I will try to get fast with the second topic. So the second topic is post-disaster human settlements. There are two types of post-disaster housing: construction in the affected area or development the new settlement outside the affected areas. As a general trend, as general tendency, then usually the government tries to build the new settlement outside the affected areas. It happens on the slope on Mount Merapi. Also, it happens on post-tsunami in Aceh. But some scholars have reminded us that building settlement in the new places is much more complicated than rebuilding in the old sites, as it will relate to economic and political aspects of livelihoods, as well as other social and cultural aspects. We will see this complicated problem in the following slides. So I want to stress that housing is actually only one of at least three special functions that should be reorganized during post-disaster recovery. The other functions are walking and homing. Um, So there are three functions: housing, working, and homing. Housing is indeed the center of attention of any post-disaster recovery program, which has in turn diminished other special functions. This is also happened in post-tsunami in Aceh and also post-tsunami post-eruption in Merapi. The center of attention of donor and government is housing. And then the second function is working. So this issue usually takes also the government attention during the recovery programs, but usually in the sense of caritative action, only giving aid for economic recovery or giving new economic skill training for the locals. And in this sense, then the economic recovery is usually based on the local themselves, not based on the government intervention. A critical problem usually neglected is that this post-disaster settlement may emerge a new problem related to the survivor livelihoods. Because usually the new place to stay is far from the livelihood sources or does not provide a place to work. So this is the issue in the working function. The third function is homing function. It is the most neglected one in the post-disaster recovery program. In this point, we should differentiate between house and home. House refers to the physical function, then home refers to the psychological and social function. It is about feeling at home and bonding with social groups. Then I found five different types of redistribution of task kits: returning with the new adaptation, relocation with new adaptation, and total relocation. What my point is that this variety is very common in post-disaster context, but very often this phenomena was not taken into account in the recovery processes. So I will say that a natural disaster and the following recovery processes may produce a multiple destructed landscape. In this sense, then the working function in specific place and then living function in different place. And then this destructed landscape will sharply decrease people's engagement with the given landscape. Also then, this destructed landscape will become the basis of more complex cultural changes in the post-disaster society. For example, the spatial segmentation of tasks bring along also temporal segmentation. The clear boundary between residential and working zone implies a clear boundary between working and non-working hours. And then another social consequences, for example, then the social relations are more and more mechanical and more contractual. Okay, then I think I can jump to the conclusion. So the main idea of my talk is that natural disaster and their subsequent recovery processes will transform landscape in different degrees. And this post-disaster landscape transformation may involve two seemingly contradictory models: integrating nature and culture or separating nature and culture. This dilemma of nature and culture is manifested in post-disaster landscape transformation, especially through three central manifestations: post-disaster spatial categorization, then post-disaster human settlement, and post-disaster remembering and mitigations. We can see here two levels of dichotomy, also two levels of interrelation. At the first level, then there is a dichotomy of nature and culture. At this level, we may notice that the critics of this dichotomy have usefully emphasized the relational idea that nature and culture are interrelated with one another. They are not in opposition, but they are in certain contextual relations. From their ethnographic studies, then some anthropologists have criticized this nature and culture dichotomy, arguing that there are diverse ways of relating nature and culture outside of nature and culture dichotomy in diverse society, in non-Western or pre-Western societies. At the second level, then we may see a dichotomy between say the modernist view and non-modernist view. At this level, then the dichotomy of nature versus culture is a very specific modern way of thinking, which is in contrast with other non or pre-modern ways of thinking that emphasize the relation between nature and culture. So I feel that this kind of dichotomy implicitly exists in some studies about nature and culture. That modern perspective, modern dichotomy of nature and culture versus non-modern perspective of nature and culture, which emphasize the relation of nature and culture. Then at this point, I will argue that from my studies, this two modern and non-modern, they are not in dichotomy, but they are in relation based on specific context. People can easily mix and move between this modern and non-modern way of thinking. So I think that's all my talk this afternoon. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And so now we have time for questions. So Oscar, there's already one question here.
Sorry, Israel, how to stop share and then okay.
Thanks for your talk, Mosayin. You mentioned at some point that from your research, you found that disaster-related sign relationships are mostly lexical and iconic. And I wonder if this has to do with the fact that natural disasters disrupt human habits, or can you elaborate on this index icon prevalence?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So my location of studies can be considered as disaster-prone areas. It means that natural disaster happens in high intensity in the past periods. So in this sense, then we may argue or we may assume that the local community should already have their own way of adapting with their instable environment. Then in this sense, this disaster is not actually disturbing their culture, but disaster has been integrated as part of their culture. They have their own way how to respond, how to avoid, how to integrate this natural hazard for their daily life. It is very, very, very common in disaster-prone areas. Some scholars say something like that. And then Craig Bancroft say this phenomenon as culture of disaster. And then I found that in this culture of disaster, from semiotic point of view, then the relation, how people relate the natural hazard in their environment and with their culture, then mostly based on indexical and iconic relation with their environment. So this indexical and iconic relation with their environment become the basis of their strong interrelation with the local environment. And then in the next step, then further it will create their cultural identity, something like that. So this their cultural identity is based on their strong relation with their environment, including the frequent natural hazards.
Yeah, that doesn't necessarily mean that symbolic relations are not ingrained into this type of culture that you just mentioned, right? So maybe it's just highlighting some aspect of this kind of
yes.
But in the background, there is all symbolic thing that you showed.
Yes, yeah. Indeed, in symbolic sign is also important to understand this culture of disaster. I will give an example from the local communities on the slope of Mount Merapi. Some of them have the local myth of big stone, only big stone. Then local people usually told, don't do bad behavior to this stone. Don't put garbage or trash near this stone. Or even don't try to break this stone, because this stone belongs to the spirits, to the power spirits. But one of the old local told me, actually the importance of this stone is in semiotic term is index of previous eruption. This stone is the material from the previous eruption. It means that if the big eruption happened, it can reach this place. It can reach this village. So in this sense, we should maintain this stone because it is important. And how they maintain this stone, they create a kind of local myth. So it is a close relation with index and symbolic sign.
Thank you. We have time for more questions. Can you come close?
So, it's always nice to hear.
Ask your one.
What I'm interested in is this concept of housing or homes.
Uh-huh.
And of course, after these disasters, this psychological, social aspects are quite disrupted.
Uh-huh.
And I was wondering if you have looked at any sort of further disruptions with this home in regards to people being settled in disaster prone areas.
Mm-hmm.
And areas that are less disaster prone. So,
mm-hmm.
So after this disaster, it seems that the communities are separated spatially, but I was wondering if there's any sort of cultural, social issues that develop
mm-hmm.
after these disasters too.
Okay, yeah. I will say that this post-disaster housing new settlement has become the basis of much more complicated problems, social and cultural problems in post-disaster. I have mentioned that when government decided to rebuild the new houses outside the affected areas, it means the new houses are located in different area with the old hamlet, then many problems emerge. For example, because in these new locations, new settlement, people do not have any important resources for their daily activities, then they still maintain their old hamlets for economic resources, usually for economic resources. So they have two distracted landscape. They have walking place in the old hamlet. They have housing place in the new settlement. Not really homing, because in any post-disaster human settlement, then the standard of new settlement after disaster is urban housing standard. On the slope of Mount Merapi, then each family they receive 100 square meters of land, piece of land. It is exactly next to the neighbor land and house. It is very different from their house in their original hamlet, where one family usually occupy a large area of field, and then the space or distance from one house with another house is quite big. Then this new model, urban housing model, has has created some new problems. For example, then social jealousy, then theft, and then and infidelity and social quarrels. So some head of Hamlets told me there are a lot of problems in the in this new in new housing. Moreover, when a family has a kid and then the kid getting married, it means in this small house there are two families. It is not enough. So where should this new family move? They are they have no other option except move to their old hamlet. So a lot of problem comes from this new kind of settlement, and this is usually neglected in post-disaster recovery program, neglected by the government and the donor. For them, the main point is building house. That's all, something like that.
But have you seen this kind of homing problem in people that came back in the old houses? Because I draw the parallel with in France, we have a lot of floods that can happen, and sometimes entire village are completely destroyed. And some people are coming back in their house and rebuild, and some of them are unable to live where they almost died, in fact. And they don't want to live here anymore because it's the same house, but it didn't feel home anymore. Have you seen this kind of issue also with this difference house, home?
Yes, this phenomena I found also in post-tsunami Aceh. Some people get lost their feeling at home at their old place, and they choose to move far away from the beach. But in contrast, some people really feel at home, really feel of recovery when they get back to their home, to their place, get back to their neighbor, get back to their environment, and they feel recovery. So it, I don't know, it seems that people who rely on natural resources for their livelihood usually have more strong relation with their place, so they usually prefer to back to their home place. But people in more urban areas usually gets weaker relation with their home place. We can imagine, because some people before the disaster, some people in urban areas have already disrupted landscape. They have their house as homing and housing function, but they have their working function in different places. So this already, they have already destructed landscape, something like that.
Okay, so thank you very much, Musayin. And now we will move on with our second presenter. We have Professor Tim O'Maran, who is a professor of biosemiotics and environmental humanities and head of our department of semiotics here in Tartus. I guess you are all very well familiar with his work, and you know that he's been working with ecosemiotics and ecocriticism and Estonian nature writing and semiotic relations to nature and culture. And he's also a very good poet. And so, well, without any further ado, I leave you with Professor Maran.
Thank you. Let me see if I'm able to share a screen. Mm-hmm. So, is it also visible from the other side of?
Yes.
Yeah, very good. Very good. So I will continue to talk about difficult problems and crises, but it will not be about the crisis that we have